Good evening. I was given one announcement, and that is Ryan Moody, a friend of the Hinesleys, has been diagnosed with cancer. So let's just make sure to keep Ryan Moody in our prayers. But that's all I have. We'll go ahead and get started with number 521.
That's number 521. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanzas. Let us sing.
I've a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll know as for the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there it is with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. I am on my way to those mansions fair, just over in the glory land, there to sing God's grace and His glory share, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. With the blood washed strong, I will shout and sing, just over in the glory land. Glad hosannas to Christ the Lord and King, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land.
Our next song will be number 210. That's number 210. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanzas. Let us sing.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me 'neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus,
Give you the praise and the glory and the honor for this privilege that we have. And dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this congregation here, that it can ever grow and prosper, be a guiding light to this community, but not only to this community, dear Heavenly Father, but to the world over, and the things that you allow us to do here, all the different works that we have going. We want to thank you for these, that we can be able to help bring souls to you before it be too late. And dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for your Son that came to this earth and suffered and died upon the cross, that through his dying upon that cross, we could have that hope to be with you someday in heaven if we do thy will. And dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for all the many blessings you bestow upon us each and every day. There's too many to count. But we want to thank you for each and everything that you do for us. And dear Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with us through this service, that everything we do be according to thy holy and divine will, that will be acceptable to you. And we ask you, dear Heavenly Father, to bless Brother Brock as he brings the lesson tonight, that he can bring it and each one can understand thy holy and divine word and be able to live closer to you. And we want to thank you for the series that he's teaching right now, and just helping to go through it and helping with the things that he does, and to bring it out in a manner that we can apply it to our lives. Now, dear Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless the sick, especially those that were mentioned here today. Give them back a portion of health as you would see fit. And those that's lost loved ones, we ask you to bless them in their time of bereavement, that they may look to you for the guidance that they need. Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for the rulers that we have, but we ask you to bless them that they'll always look to your word for the guidance that they need, and that they'll always make laws that we can always be able to have this freedom to worship you openly and freely. And dear Heavenly Father, we just ask you to bless the young people that we have here, that they will be the future of this congregation, but not only this congregation, that they may be able to spread out and be able to be in other congregations and help them grow and prosper. And now, dear Heavenly Father, we just ask you to go with us and lead us and guide us and direct us in all your ways. For it's in Jesus' name we do humbly pray. Amen.
Next song will be number 326. It's number 326. We'll sing all three stanzas, and it's big convenient of stanzas in the song. Let us sing.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms.
would, take your copy of God's Word, and let's locate the general epistle known as 1 John. And we'll begin tonight in 1 John just for a moment. Let's consider some passages from 1 John about liars, about lies, and about lying. Let's look at 1 John chapter 1, notice verse number 6. If we say that we have fellowship, partnership, joint association with Him, that is God, and walk in darkness, that is not in the light, as God is in the light, we lie and do not the truth. Notice verse 8, same chapter. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Notice verse 10, same chapter. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar. We make God a liar. And His Word is not in us. So there's the deception that's often associated with liars, lies, and lying. Now notice 1 John 2 and verse 4. He that saith, I know Him, and keepeth not His commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. So notice the disobedience that's often associated with liars, lies, and lying in general. Stay in chapter 2, but notice verses 21 and 22. I have not written unto you because you know not the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Move forward to 1 John 5 and verse 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath a witness in himself. He that believeth not, God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. So notice sometimes the aspect of denial that is associated with liars, lies, and lying in general. Now notice 1 John 4 verses 20 and 21. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. So notice the sense of desolation that can come about from liars, lies, and lying. We're dealing with matters of ethics, and ethics really deals with moral behavior, especially toward others. And we're dealing with the aspect of lying. This morning, we covered the distinctions. And when we say we covered them, we touched on several things, that jokes and whatnot, that we need to make a distinction between jokes and lying, between the changing of appearance in some instances and lying, withholding information and lying, and then just flat out lying. We also noticed this morning the despicableness of lying, basically from Proverbs, but we did notice some passages in the New Testament that this is something condemned really all throughout the Word of God. Tonight we're going to talk about the distress that is caused to self and to others by lies and by lying. Then we'll also talk about the doom of all unrepentant liars who practice the sin of lying. Now, what we want to do here is really, this is the third point. This is really a continuation of this morning's sermon. And let's read the text of 1 Kings chapter 13. Not the whole chapter, but we're going to make some applications and observations through this. But let's read the text, follow along with 1 Kings chapter 13. We'll pick up in verse 11, and we're going to read through verse 19, and then we're going to make several observations from other passages in the chapter, as well as some that we're going to read. 1 Kings 13, 11. Now there dwelt an old prophet. All right, old prophet. Was he a prophet used to be, like old used to be, or was he up in age? He may be both of those things. He may have been older in age, and he may have truly used to have been a prophet. So keep that in your mind. Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God. All right, count how many times through this chapter, we're not going to do it, but how many times you come across the phrase the man of God. That seems to indicate what we might know as a younger prophet. Okay, the man of God had done that day in Bethel. The words which he had spoken unto the king, them they told also to their father. And their father said unto them, What way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah. And he said unto his sons, Saddle me, I'm going to take some Christian liberty here, saddle me the donkey. So they saddled him the donkey, and he rode thereon. And went after the man of God, and found him sitting under an oak. And he said unto him, Art thou the man of God that camest from Judah? And he said, I am. Then he said unto him, Come home with me and eat bread. Now start paying attention, especially as this deals with lying. And he said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water with thee in this place. For, here's the reason, it was said to me by the word of the Lord. So this man of God seems to have been a current, genuine prophet. Okay? Thou shalt eat no bread, nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. Now pay attention to verse 18. He, this old prophet, said unto him, the man of God, evidently a younger prophet, I am a prophet also as thou art. The I am makes that a questionable statement. He may have been, but it does not appear that he was currently still speaking by inspiration of God. I am a prophet also as thou art, and an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord. That's not true. Saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. What does your copy of God's word say? But he lied unto him. Verse 19. So he, the man of God, the current prophet, went back with him, the old prophet, and did eat bread in his house and drank water. One of the things that we want to point out before we even really look at other passages in this chapter, is that one of the most difficult aspects of lying is being consistent with the lies. You know, the truth doesn't change. So what's correct today will be correct tomorrow. And what's told to this person will be the same thing told to that person, and it's really easy to tell the truth because the truth doesn't change. But lying causes distress if for no other reason keeping track with what lie has been told to whom and when. And that in and of itself would cause distress to the one who tells the lie. But then what happens, and we're going to see what can happen when we hear a lie and believe a lie and obey a lie. It will cause distress in the lives of those who might hear, believe, and obey that lie. Now we want to point out several things. The first thing is this: God's word will come to pass. Some of these are going to be about God's word, and then you're going to see how we try and dial this down. Look at verse 3 and verse 5. Same chapter. And he gave a sign the same day, saying, This is the sign which the Lord hath spoken. Behold, the altar shall be rent, and the ashes that are upon it shall be poured out. Skip down to verse 5. The altar also was rent, and the ashes poured out from the altar, according to the sign which the man of God, this evidently younger prophet, had given by the word of the Lord. So one thing, an application from this that we're looking at, is that God's word will come to pass. The altar was rent, and the ashes were poured out, just like God's word said would happen. Another observation is in verse 4. God's word will be opposed. Notice verse 4 of the same chapter. And it came to pass when King Jeroboam, we might know him as Jeroboam the son of Nebat, the first king of the divided kingdom, that is the northern kingdom of Israel, heard the saying of the man of God, which had cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, Lay hold on him. And his hand which he put forth against him dried up, so that he could not pull it in again. So notice where Jeroboam the king had said, Lay hold on him. What do you mean? Pat this young prophet, this man of God, on the back? I don't think so. This was in opposition to God's word. Now, here's where we get to the meat of what we really want to dial in on. God's word is not, let's repeat this, God's word is not contradictory. Notice verse number 9. For so it was charged me by the word of the Lord, saying, Eat no bread, nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way that thou camest. That's the truth. That's the truth. That's what the man of God was supposed to do. That's what God had told him to do. Now look again at verse 18. Here we have this old prophet, And what does he do? Everything this old prophet says is in direct contradiction to what God had said. He said also to him, I am a prophet also as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. But what does the Holy Spirit tell us? That this man of God did not know or did not recognize at the time. But he lied unto him. So please note that God's word is not contradictory. God had said, verse 9, this so-called old prophet said, verse 18, and what did the Holy Spirit tell us about what the old prophet said? It was a lie. Now notice this. It is possible. It is not permissible, but it is possible for religious people to lie about God's word. Is that not what this man in verse 18 did? He lied. He flat out lied about God's word. Now notice something that's very sad, that this becomes very practical when we stop and think about it. Some will accept the word of the preacher over the word of God. It's a big problem. Notice verse 19. So he, the man of God, evidently this younger prophet, went back with him, the old prophet, and did eat bread in his house and drank water. So he did exactly what the word of the Lord had told him not to do. It's a shame when some accept a preacher's word over God's word. Now here's the sadness. When we hear a lie and believe a lie and obey a lie, death follows. Look at verses 23 and 24. And it came to pass after he, the man of God, had eaten bread, and after he, the man of God, had drunk, that he saddled for him the, Christian Liberty, donkey, to wit, for the prophet whom he had brought back. And when he was gone, a lion met him by the way and slew him. Him who? The man of God, the younger prophet. And his carcass was cast in the way, and the donkey stood by it, and the lion also stood by the carcass. Look at verse 26. And when the prophet that brought him back from the way heard thereof, he said, it is the man of God who was disobedient unto the word of the Lord. Therefore the Lord hath delivered him unto the lion, which hath torn him and slain him according to the word of the Lord which he spake unto him. I read this and I go, why did this old prophet lie? Why did this old prophet lie to the man of God? I've read this and read this and read this, and the best answer is, I don't know. I don't know why he did what he did, but look at the result of what he did. And one thing that I can say is that this old prophet still had to live with himself and the decisions that he made. So what can we learn from this? There is a sense of distress that is caused both to self and to others by lying. And when we hear a lie and believe a lie and obey a lie, we may not get eaten by a lion, okay? But we will die spiritually when we hear a lie and believe a lie and obey a lie. Now, we've asked this question for years. Whose word is more powerful, the devil's or God's? Well, if it's true, and I think we can establish that when we hear a lie, believe a lie, and obey a lie, we're in trouble. Well, what do when we hear the truth, believe the truth, and obey the truth? God's word is always more powerful than the devil's. Now, in the fourth place, let's talk about the doom. That is the doom of all unrepentant liars who practice the sin of lying. Let's move forward into the New Testament. Let's notice Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. This is probably more of a familiar account than perhaps what we looked at in 1 Kings 13. But this is about Ananias and Sapphira, and there are seven parts to this, and we're not going to draw them out. But as you read back through this, think about the contrast. Think about what Barnabas does, and then think about the contrast that happens at the end of chapter 4 with the beginning of chapter 5 in the book of Acts. Then think about the conspirators. That would be Ananias and Sapphira. That would be a husband and wife. Think about the conspiracy. Think about what they did. Evidently, they decided that they were going to present that they had sold what they had for this amount, okay, but really they got more than what they presented. So there was a sense of conspiracy that happened here. The thing that might sometimes go unstated is the capability. Number one, that would be the capability of God. Can't fool him. We also begin to see some of the capabilities of the apostles of Jesus Christ And it would seem from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 11, that there were 9 broad spiritual gifts, miraculous abilities, in the first century. The implication is the apostles had them all. And one of those 9 gifts was called the discerning of spirits. What does that mean? It means it'd be rather hard to lie to an apostle and get away with it. And I think we're going to find out. You're going to see people that lied to an apostle, and they did not get away with it. We're also going to see the confrontation where Peter himself confronted Ananias and Sapphira over what they had done. Then we're going to see the cost. We're going to see the cost that can be associated with telling lies. And then the correction that happens from two individuals who lied, who paid the price for that, and how it straightened up basically everybody. Now, we're not going to point all those things out as we read through this, but keep those things in your mind as we notice the text of Acts 5, 1 through 11. But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy, that is, aware of it, privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. That is, he died. He breathed his last. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. Verse 6, and the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out, and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, tell me whether ye sold the land for so much. And she said, yea, for so much. What is that? That is an untrue statement designed to deceive. That's a lie. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye, that's both Ananias, her husband, and Sapphira, this woman herself, have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then she fell down straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost. She breathed her last. That is, she died. And the young men came in and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things. Think about the contrast, the conspirators, the conspiracy, the capability, the confrontation, the cost, and the correction. What happens to those who experience physical death while practicing sin? What happens to those who experience physical death when the last thing that they really have done is tell a lie? Let's move forward to the book of Revelation. And notice the text of Revelation 21, verse 8. While we're there, we'll probably notice another verse in Revelation 22. But notice with me the text of Revelation 21, verse 8. I say we, and I'm speaking broadly of human beings, at least 21st century Americans, we categorize things and say, well, a lie's not that bad. I mean, it's not. I'm not a murderer. I'm not an adulterer. I'm not this. I'm not that. So if I tell a little white lie, which incidentally, there is no such thing. That's a concoction from human minds, that there's such a thing as a little white lie. It's not as bad as other things. Just look at the category of things named in Revelation 21 and verse 8. But, that's a contrast, the fearful. Some translations, I believe the New King James says, the cowardly, and unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So what happens to those who experience physical death while practicing sin? You lose your soul. And if you lose your soul, you've lost it all. You mean to tell me that telling lies could cost me my soul? Yes. That's exactly what I'm up here saying. I'm saying that lying is a sin. And no matter how we might categorize sin, if it is the missing of the mark established by God in His Word, especially for us, the New Testament, it will cost us our soul if we die with that sin on our ledger, so to speak, with that scar against our soul. While your Bible's open there, if your Bible's like mine, just move across the page to Revelation 22 and verse 15. For without, who's standing outside of the city? For without, outside are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters. And notice how the verse ends. And whosoever, that's a universal statement, loveth and maketh a lie. No matter what the world has taught us all throughout our lives, lying is a sin. Lying is a terrible, terrible sin. And there is a sense of doom that is associated with those who die with unrepentant sin in their lives, such as lies. We said it this morning and we'll say it again. There is no such thing as a little white lie. The Bible does not teach that lies come in sizes or colors. It might be interesting, if anybody did it, to look up what the English word fib means. It's sad, it's shocking, at the way that our culture has, for many years now, devalued truth, devalued accuracy, devalued honesty, devalued integrity, and that we've said, that's irrelevant. It doesn't really matter if I tell the truth about that. Well, if it doesn't matter if I really tell the truth about that, then what happens when we begin to get to serious or weightier matters? If we'll lie about nothing, then we'll lie about anything. And that's the truth of it. There is no situation where lying is the right, correct, or scriptural thing to do. Lying is always sinful. Is this a lie? Is this a lie? Is this the truth of God's word? Or are these statements designed to deceive because they are obviously untrue? What must I do to be saved? Hear the gospel. Acts 18:8. Believe the gospel. Acts 16:31. Repent of sin. Acts 17:30. Confess Jesus Christ to be the Son of God. Acts 8:37. And be immersed in water for the remission of sins. Acts 2:38. That's how and where the blood of Christ is applied to your soul. That's how to become a Christian. That's how to be added by the Lord to the Lord's church, the church of Christ, the pillar and ground of the truth. Once we become a Christian, it's time to behave as a Christian. Well, how do Christians behave? Are we a bunch of liars? Is that who we are? We're a bunch of dishonest, deceitful liars? That is not the behavior of a Christian, anywhere and at any time. But the truth is, if we're not careful, we might feel the temptation in certain scenarios to say, well, the easy thing for me to do is lie. And we might do that and succumb to the sin of lying when we know better as blood-washed, born-again Christians. So what do? Do we just act like it didn't happen? It's not a big deal. It is a big deal. So how do we make it right? As the children of God, repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven, the Acts 8:22. Wherever you are, make it right. Do it now. Do it as together we stand and as we sing the song of encouragement.
Have thine affections been nailed to the cross?
Is thine heart
right with God? Dost thou count all things for Jesus but loss? Is thine heart right with God? Is thine heart right with God? Washed in the crimson flood, cleansed and made holy, humble and low.
We now have an opportunity to take the Lord's Supper for those that did not have an opportunity earlier today. Let's all go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the blessing of your Son, the sacrifice that was made for our sins, yet he committed no sin. We pray now for those who are about to partake of this bread, which to us is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that died on the cross for our sins. We pray now for those who are about to partake, that they would do so in a manner well-pleasing and acceptable to thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us give thanks for the fruit of the vine. Heavenly Father, we come before you now thanking for you for this fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's shed blood upon the cross for the sin of mankind. Heavenly Father, we pray that you'll be with those that are about to partake, that they will go back to the cross, remember the great love that you and your Son had for them, and that they will reflect back to that, and may they examine themselves, may they partake of it in a manner pleasing to thy sight. This is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you now thanking you for all the many blessings that we enjoy. We know that all good things come from thee, Heavenly Father, and we thank you for the physical blessings that you provide for us, and we thank you for the spiritual blessings that we have through your Son, Jesus. We pray for those that are about to give, that they will give with a cheerful heart, and able to give as they've been prospered. This is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. To our visitors, you're welcome, and all the guests. As always, let's make sure we keep those that are listed in the second shout in our daily prayers after there's no further announcements. Let's all stand for the closing prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for another first day of the week. We thank you for this opportunity we've had to be here, to be together, to be thy church, to to encourage each other. And we pray, Lord, that we'll always not forsake the assembly, but we'll always be here to encourage each other. But we pray, Lord, that we'll always be here to open our ears and our eyes and to hear and to see thy word. And we pray, Lord, that we've done that today, that we've allowed thy word to sink in. And we pray, Lord, that our hearts have become that fertile soil that takes it in and allows it to grow in our hearts. And we take it with us each and every day as we go along the path of life. We thank you, Lord, for the lessons that we heard today. And we pray, Lord, that we take that to heart and we try to understand truly what a lie is and how to avoid being telling lies and how to avoid being caught into things that we don't want to be in, that we live properly and respectfully of others according to thy word, that we always allow thy word to lead and guide the things that we do and say each and every day. Thank you for the many that have been healed, but we pray, Lord, for those that are continually on our sick list, those that have sickness and various health issues that are many. We pray, Lord, that you know their illness and sickness, that you give those that are caring for them the wisdom and the knowledge to bring them back to better health, that they may be returned to us soon. And we pray for those of our number that may be traveling or away from here at this time, that they'll have a safe journey and be back with us soon. Thank you for Brock and his willingness to be here and teach and preach, but we thank you for Brock and Frankie and John being our elders and doing the things that are necessary to make the decisions that are necessary for us all to be on the path that leads us to you. Thank you for them and their work. And we thank you for each person that is here. And we pray, Lord, that we all can be together and be one, just as thy word tells us to be, that we all be together and encourage each other and that we all strengthen each other. We pray, Lord, that our worship here today has been holy and acceptable in thy sight. And we pray for peace throughout the world, Lord, that the nations and the leaders of the nations will seek ways to come to an easy way to dissolve the disputes that are there and the other issues that may go to cause wars and other wars. So we pray, Lord, that you give them the wisdom and the knowledge to peacefully come to a solution that we all can live with. Thank you, Lord, for this day. And it's not our will, but thy will that we ask. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.